Welcome to Asian Times TV. In light of the mass shooting in Newtown, Connecticut, where 20 very young, innocent children and 6 adults were brutally gunned down, it has raised the highly politicized debate again about gun control in the United States. We have with us today a very special guest who's familiar with the debate from the August 23rd, 2012 incident when a similar shooting took place at a Sikh temple in Wisconsin where 6 worshipers were murdered. Mr. Harpreet Singh Sandhu was there to counsel the parishioners in Oak Creek, Wisconsin, Gurdwara. He's a Democratic delegate from California. He's politically active on the West Coast. I met him at the DNC convention, which had the largest number of Sikh delegates this year in North Carolina. He has kept up with the political developments in the wake of these mass shootings. Mr. Sandhu, welcome to Asian Times TV. Good to see you again.
Dr. Dinesh, thank you for having me on.
Welcome, welcome. So tell me, what is your reaction in terms of the, you know, in terms of the recent events and, you know, obviously the eerie similarity to what happened in Wisconsin?
Absolutely dreadful. I can just imagine what the families are going through. When Wisconsin happened, I had the opportunity to be there 2 or 3 days later and really working close with some of the families. Mm-hmm. And I can only say that having seen those families and what they're going through currently, and at the time it has broken the family structure and because they've lost loved ones, they were breadwinners and so forth. But here, this shooting is just is hurting all the families throughout the country because you've lost young children. Mm-hmm. Children, each one of us can't imagine having our 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds, some come to this brutality. Mm-hmm. And again, as you mentioned, this again raises the concerns about gun violence and in general throughout this country.
Mm-hmm. So what is your, I know you obviously looked at this in detail, what is your view then on sort of the banning of, you know, assault or semi-assault weapons, which was also used in the Wisconsin shooting, right?
I think we need to take those steps forward. The president has come forward, put together a team of people who are going to come back and give a decision quickly, not sit around for months and months. I think it's in the right direction. I don't think we need weapons such as the ones that are somehow AR-15s and so forth, machine guns, for just having in the homes. I can imagine them on a battlefield, but not at homes. Mm-hmm. When I served on the city council in Richmond, we did pass somewhat of a, we could call it a bill or a proposition not to allow larger cartridges to be sold in the city of Richmond. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you there's a lot of pressure when you're trying to make these decisions, and the NRA and does put the pressure on elected officials when we're trying to move in this direction.
Right, and Senator Feinstein, of course, is quite actively trying to reinstitute the, you know, the earlier ban that we had during the 90s on assault and semi-assault weapons. Is that right?
Absolutely, and keep in mind that that was also passed even prior to that with President Reagan, the Brady Bill in banning of these semi-automatic guns. Mm-hmm. So it has wide range of support from all elected officials. Mm-hmm. I think we need to get back on track and do that again throughout the country.
Right. Now, what is the update on the Wisconsin shooting? You know, were there any changes that were brought about in laws or in, you know, or even sort of gun possession as a result of that shooting?
Obviously, the FBI came with the decision that this was a lone person who did not have a larger people working with him. That might be the case, but this individual was part of a group that was a rock band that talked about hate against other people. So, yeah, that's a decision of the FBI, but I think there's a larger context this person worked in. As to what's moving forward, Senator Durbin did hold a meeting in the Senate talking about these issues and also hate crime, in particular against Sikhs, because keep in mind that when a hate crime does happen against Sikhs, it's characterized as a under the Muslim, because they feel that people are mistaken for being Muslim, so it actually is a hate crime against Muslim, not against Sikhs. Mm-hmm. And we're moving forward in adding a couple of other categories, including hate crime against Sikhs as part of this moving forward. And the FBI will now track that to be the case, but not till 2015, unfortunately.
Okay, so you're saying it's getting classified as a hate crime, but not as a an act of a organized group, like a white supremacist group, which is what was also partly in the press at the time. You're saying that's not what happened?
I think that is what has been characterized, okay, not by a group, but it is a hate crime. The president came out, okay, and everybody else has, and the director of FBI came out. That it is a hate crime.
Okay.
It just isn't as if it's done by a group of individuals.
I see.
And you know, unfortunately, I must say that when hate crimes like these do occur, if there were happen to be other organizations, there would be bans again, all sorts of things, freezing of the funds and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, the white supremacists in this country do enjoy, I hate to say, a bit more liberty in the government going after them.
Mm-hmm.
It may not have been the case had it been somebody else. And I think we need to move aggressively against some of these organizations. So I think that is a hate crime, and it should be against a group of people such as the white supremacists in Wisconsin, which has a large amount of people living who prescribe to this kind of a organization.
So tell me about the area, Oak Creek. You know, earlier you mentioned the confusion between profiling. Somehow Sikhs are getting, obviously after 9/11, a large number of them were profiled or wrongly profiled as Muslims and become targets of crimes against them. Is that what, that's partly what happened here as well, right, with the Wisconsin shooting?
In case of Wisconsin, as I mentioned, I don't think it was a mistaken identity, because the individual who lived in that town, there's a large mosque that is in Wisconsin, mm-hmm, Oak Creek.
Mm-hmm.
He was quite familiar with this area. He would have known where the mosque was. Individual had got in the city of Oak Creek. There is a mosque, so I don't think he would have just lost his way going to the mosque and came upon this temple. He was quite well aware this place was, and he targeted the Sikhs, I believe, because the town has a Muslim community there living, and he went to the temple to do the shooting at.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So in terms of the changes in laws, you're saying there wasn't anything that was substantially changed as yet. Is that your understanding?
In terms of identifying hate against Sikhs as a hate crime, not as of yet. Whenever there is a crime that does occur, it is always characterized under the Muslim, because they feel that the crime was being committed against a Muslim, so it was against the Muslim community. Senator Durbin did hold hearings,
mm-hmm,
with the FBI, and so they will add other categories within the hate crime, so unfortunately that will not come upon until at least 2015.
So in terms of the profiling aspect of the shooting that took place in Wisconsin, the confusion between Sikhs, you know, getting misidentified as Muslims, you're saying that wasn't the case necessarily in the Wisconsin shooting?
At other places, perhaps, but not in Wisconsin. As I mentioned before, there's a mosque that is right there, about maybe half a mile away from the temple. And the individual, obviously, who is familiar with the town, would have known where the mosque is versus where the temple is. So he specifically went to the temple, and this shooting occurred at that point. So in this case, I strongly feel it was not a mistaken identity.
Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of what the FBI found, they didn't find any kind of a motive, right? It was kind of a hate crime, white supremacist group. He was a, you know, somebody who perhaps was also unstable psychologically, you know, based on his background.
Obviously, he had a military background, and in terms of being connected to any large organization, they said that he was a lone gunman.
Mm-hmm.
And so the crime, they feel, is not connected to any organization.
Right.
Yet he was a prominent member of a hate crime group, a band,
mm-hmm,
which obviously profused hate messages to large public. So I don't see how he would not have been connected to something and yet call himself a lone gunman.
Right. Now, in terms of gun violence, though, the shooting in Wisconsin didn't bring any changes in gun laws as well, right?
Obviously, it did not. And as the president mentioned, under his presidency, this is the fourth heinous crime that's been committed against individuals. So I think the country has come to a tipping point where that some action needs to be taken place. Sadly, even though these are high profile, even after the incidents, last incidents, 8 to 10 people have been victims of gun violence. So as the numbers say, there's up to 10,000 people killed every year in this kind of violence. So something really needs to be done. I think we are a country that has too large of a homicide rate just based on violence committed by gun violence of this type.
Yeah, I mean, it's clearly an epidemic. I mean, the number is on the order, as you mentioned, around 10,000 or higher, which is far higher than any other country, any sort of modern, developed, civilized country where people are allowed to possess guns. And even in countries in the Middle East, for instance, in Israel, where people do carry guns, but there are lots of checks in place, and it, you know, it obviously leads to several barriers to gun possession or using them or misfiring them. And of course, you know, a lot of times it's the family members who are the victims, as in this case, the gunman shot apparently his mother, you know, in Connecticut we're talking about, and then obviously went to the school. Now, so I think hopefully, are you suggesting that the Sikh community is going to be actively also lobbying then, partly for some sort of a stronger ban on automatic and semi-automatic weapons?
I would encourage them, and I think they will be lobbying. Living in California, obviously, with Senator Feinstein and other members of Congress, we have a large majority. Mm-hmm. We will make every effort available to our representative, make that communication brought to them that this is something that the Sikh community really does want to move forward to. I hate to say this, but at the temple in the El Sabrand area, we lost a member of the community also to an individual who actually used a semi-automatic gun. So I believe the possession of these things really should be banned. I encourage if those who are not on board to please lobby their representatives to move forward with this kind of a restriction on semi-automatic guns.
Right. Now, on the West Coast, when I saw you at the DNC, there was a large contingency of Sikh Americans that were represented as part of the California delegate. So explain to me how that has come about, partly obviously because of the history of Sikh Americans on the West Coast is longer, it goes back 100 years at least, right?
Right. We this year celebrated the oldest temple in Stockton that's been there for over 100 years. Mm-hmm. And so the migration into this country on the Pacific side was largely into California and Oregon, Washington, and obviously there was immigrations into Canada. So California, Angel Island is perhaps was the island where people came, and even today you can see pictures and artifacts of Sikhs who came in the late 1800s and the 1900s through this. Mm-hmm. California obviously is just like people came from Punjab, a breadbasket. Mm-hmm. So this was a very much of a place they were acclimated to. Mm-hmm. And worked in all sorts of fields. But keep in mind that in the early 1900s, a lot of people came to the university to study here as well, mm-hmm. and many stayed on, as people do today as well. So California was very much of a place. In terms of the delegates, there's a large population. The people were enthusiastic about this presence Barack Obama, mm-hmm. and many people went on to run to become delegates. There were 28 people who ran, of them 26 won, mm-hmm. and that came from different 15 different congressional districts. Mm-hmm. So it was a large contingent. I think Indians as a whole, there were over 100 people, 150 people that came this year. Last time in 2008 were about 100. Mm-hmm. But this year, Sikhs have felt that they need to participate in politics, and this was one of the action that they have taken also.
Yeah, and I was lucky to sit with you, with your group on the floor. You were kind enough to invite me to sit with you guys, which I thoroughly enjoyed. And I got lots of comments on my Facebook page. People wanted to know, you know, who were these newfound friends that I had in California? Because people, well, you know, yeah.
And then individuals, although they were all worried because they felt like going to a convention, they had to make speeches or something like right. that. I said, no, it's more the fact that you're there, you're representing the voice of the people. And right. one of the most important part,
right.
you're there is to vote for, as part of your party, for the nomination of the presidentship. So, and they were very much enthusiastic once they got there. And they had a chance to go around and go to many of the meetings, the API caucus, the Women caucus, the Hispanic caucus, the African-American caucus, and really were welcomed. And mm-hmm. And you know, in 2004, my daughter was a delegate. I unfortunately was a delegate, but Howard Dean didn't make it. And I, the first thing I told her was to look around and enjoy who look around here, and then sadly look at the convention later on. And I'm not being politicalizing the Democrat Party, but it's a party that I feel that represents many of the people that were there, not only this time, but even previous years. Mm-hmm. So the larger context, the party itself is welcoming to many different minorities throughout this country.
Right. And I also saw you during the convention at the Islamic American panel as well, that was held at another location. And I, you know, as I did some interviews there as well, and you were present there as well with that group.
Right, absolutely. And different congressmen came in and spoke to that, especially in particular, sometimes when people are mistaken for Muslims with Sikhs, it was important for us to be there to say that, look, just because people mistake us for Muslim, that does not mean crime should be committed against Muslims or any other community.
Mm-hmm.
Sikhs always have stood up for the rights of all individuals,
right.
and even though people are committing crimes thinking they're against Muslims, that should not be the case either in this mm-hmm. country.
Now, the first Asian American elected to Congress, interestingly, was a gentleman named Dilip Sandh, who was a Sikh from California. Can you talk about that a bit?
Dilip Singh Sandh came to this country in 1928. And to UC Berkeley, of all places, and got a law degree. And after that, unfortunately, he was not able to practice it because the rules of this country stated that immigrants could not do those jobs. And frustrated, he went back to the southern part of California, the El Centro area, and started farming and became very active in the community. He went on to become a judge in the area and then ran for Congress in 1950s and became the first Asian to be elected as a congressman of this country. And you know, it's amazing that sometimes when we talk to other Asian communities, they are also surprised that a Sikh American who had very close ties because his wife was Hispanic, mm-hmm. As all immigrants at that time, if I also may kind of branch off, at those times, women were not allowed to come to this country. So mm-hmm. most of Sikhs at that time were married either to Hispanics, African-Americans, mm-hmm. Filipino, and whites. So most of the women at that time were of a different ethnicity.
Mm-hmm.
And in the case of Dilip Singh Sandh as well, he was married to a Hispanic person. And so he had a support from the large community and became the first congressman, and one that we cherish greatly. And forget to mention that this was his 50th anniversary last year, which was also a bust was presented in the house that stands there as his 50-year anniversary.
Right. Now, you were just at the White House on the birth of Guru Nanak just last week, I think it was, right?
Just 2 weeks ago. And you know, it's amazing that this president, this is not just the first time, this is ever since he was elected, he has been such an inclusive person of many different ethnicities and religions, and celebrated mm-hmm. Diwali and all the other religious ceremonies there, including that of the Sikhs mm-hmm. For the last 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
It's a wonderful event. It talks about how the friendship between the president and the Sikh community has grown greatly in this country.
And how many, tell me, like, how, what was the contingency like? Were there a lot of states represented at the you know, Guru Nanak's birthday event at the White House?
Just like previous years, yes, there were. There were 150 people there,
mm-hmm.
and not only people came from different states there, also from the other organization that represent Sikh, the SALDAF, Sikh Coalition, and United Sikhs,
mm-hmm.
And along with other civil rights committees there as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it was very inclusive to the community as a whole from this country. This was obviously done with the beginning with the hymns of the Guru Nanak and his contribution that is so, if you look at it, it's so synonymous with what this country also represents, of inclusions and equality among all people.
Now, just curiously, was Nikki Randhawa Haley part of the invited guests as well?
There were Republicans who were there. Unfortunately, the three times that I've been there since it started, Nikki was not there, unfortunately.
Okay. No, because she's a Sikh American as well, right? And proud to be one, I think.
She's a Sikh American, but of course, in the debate that came upon it, she rightfully says that she is a convert to the Christian religion. But of course, her parents are Sikhs, and actually from Amritsar district that you and I perhaps are close to.
Oh, yeah. And of course, her father, I think, still wears a turban. Isn't that right?
Yes, he does indeed. And is a vibrant person of that community in that state, in that city.
In South Carolina. Right?
In South Carolina.
That's right. Now, on the there are apparently six Indian American delegate candidates ran in the election, at the state level election for the U.S. Congress. But only one of them won, Ami Bera, from I think Stockton, right? The 7th district?
Yes, indeed. He did. Ricky Gill did run from that area, and Ami Bera from the Sacramento area.
Okay.
But before that, I can also touch, there were over 8 or 10 elected officials in city councils and mayorships thereabout in California. Obviously, one of the prominent races was Ricky Gill. At the end of the day, it's the numbers that come into factor. Congressman McNerney, the Democrat Party, held a 10% lead in terms of registered voters. So it was an uphill battle to start with. Some of us forget that, even though, yes, there's a large Sikh community in the area, to overcome 10% is large. At the end, Ricky lost by over 13,000 votes, 10 to 13,000, which is a large amount to a battle to overcome. Whereas Ami Bera also had been losing by 7,000 to 8,000 in the last two races. Mm-hmm. But since the redistricting took place, he had that advantage, and it was a wonderful win on the Democrat side for Ami Bera, who is an individual who's a doctor. And has very close ties with larger community and talks about the fact that of inclusiveness of all people, and that was a wonderful win.
So now apparently he's the third Asian American or third Indian American after Dilip Sohn and then Bobby Jindal to now be elected to the U.S. Congress.
As a congressman, yes. There are others who did from different parts of the country, different parts of the states, did run, and Ami would be the third.
That's right. So, but Ricky, though, Ricky Gill is a young Republican politician. He's a graduate of Princeton, and you think that he clearly has a future in politics?
Absolutely. I mean, the graduate from Princeton went on to get his law degree just this year out of UC Berkeley, and it was only 25, which is the minimum age eligible to run for Congress. Mm-hmm. I think he has a bright future, and I think we'll be seeing him in the future running for some sort of a political position somewhere.
Right.
If not, at least he will be a figure in the community.
Right. So, you know, obviously, President's sister, Maya, whom I've interviewed on this show a couple of times now, was the person who introduced us. So, and she's obviously active as well in Hawaii. Is she also somebody who's quite active, I mean, in California as a supporter?
She is. She works with an organization with children, again, underprivileged, and who are some also in difficult position in lower income communities. And so she works within California, is here quite often. And also, of course, when the elections occur on behalf of the president. Mm-hmm. So she's vibrant in the community, and so we get an interaction with her quite often whenever she comes here.
All right, fantastic. So I think we're out of our time for this interview. We'd love to have you back and talk, you know, in more detail as the political situation changes on the West Coast. And as new laws are passed, you know, whether on gun violence or, other sort of laws that are passed that impact Asian Americans, Indian Americans, or the general population. So I want to thank Harpreet Sandhu for joining us. And I want to thank our viewers for tuning in. Tune in again next week for another edition of Asian Times TV.